Welcome to Conversations on the Coast, San Francisco's premier author interview program. And joining us today is Karen Armstrong, all the way from the other side of the Atlantic, to talk about her latest book, The Great Transformation, The Beginning of Our Religious Traditions. It's published by Alfred A. Knopf. And thank you much for stopping by.
Thank you so much.
You know, I think that we could subtitle The Great Transformation this way: A Study of the Axial Age, 900 to 200 BCE, a time when the four axial peoples developed the traditions that have continued to nourish humanity, the axis of the spiritual history of humanity, you might call it. And all of this we steal from Carl Jaspers,
I guess,
who in the 1940s coined the phrase.
Yes, Carl Jaspers looked at this period when, in four distinct regions of the world, these great traditions arose independently of one another. In China, you have the rise of Confucianism and Taoism. In India, Hinduism, Buddhism, and Jainism. And in Israel, you have monotheism. There's also philosophical rationalism in Greece.
In Greece. That's the fourth one.
Yes. Yeah. And we've never really gone beyond these insights. Rabbinic Judaism, Christianity, and Islam would be secondary flowerings of that original Axial Age spirit.
Right, right. And in fact, what we know of them today is that second flowering, not the first.
Well, the first Axial Age flowering of monotheism in Israel is reflected in the Jewish scriptures, mm-hmm. which traces the growth of spirituality there, and that steals up upon Axial Age spirituality and then takes a step back. It goes by fits and starts, whereas in other regions, in China, for example, they get it at the first go with Confucius.
I see. One of the things that you point out is that what mattered most is not what you believed, but how you behaved. Mm-hmm. And that is to say, I guess, that morality becomes at the heart of the spiritual life.
None of the great sages, whether we're talking about Confucius or Buddha or the prophets of Israel, were interested at all in metaphysics or doctrine or dogma. They didn't approve of obligatory belief. The Taoists in China thought that it was unrealistic and immature to have the kind of certainty that people seem to often expect from religion. They said it was unskillful because very often we identify very, very closely with our opinions, theological mm-hmm. opinions, mm-hmm. and when we propound them, it's egos talking a lot of the time, whereas to encounter God or Brahman or the sacred, you have to get rid of ego. This was what the axial sages believed.
And in putting out these opinions or doctrines, that act can itself become a source of friction and conflict.
Yes, the Quran later on makes this very clear. It calls all theological speculation and obligatory doctrine zanna, self-indulgent guesswork, mm-hmm. about matters that nobody can prove one way or the other, but which
makes, I hope there are no theologians listening.
But which make people quarrelsome and stupidly sectarian.
Ah.
People start quarrelling about these things in a way that's counterproductive to the spiritual life.
Now, these sages of the Axial Age seem like good fellows, if you will, but one of the failings that they have is an indifference to women. And I don't know that we can blame them for that as much as we can blame the age in which they live.
That is certainly true. This was a period of great violence and economic progress, and at these times, military prowess mm-hmm. and masculine brawn was prized more than women's skills. The axial sages were not hostile to women, as later theologians would be. I'm thinking of the fathers of the church in Christianity.
Yeah.
They were real haters of women and haters of sexuality very often. The axial sages just didn't seem to see women very much.
Well, you write about how the women in many of the villages and cities would be separated off. except at certain times of the year. I mean, the men would be out.
That was just in China among among the peasant classes, but in this period, women do take a nosedive in their status. And that's been a flaw of the Axial Age religions. None of them has proved to be good for women in the long run, even though some sages, Jesus and Muhammad among them, originally had good news for women. Mm. And then later men dragged the religion back to the old patriarchy.
One of the things that bothered me as I was reading in the book is that you make a strong case for the similarities, even though these people had no kind of communication. And yet there was a good deal of intolerance. And when we come back, I want to talk about that. I want to talk about things that the various traditions shared, and at the same time how they didn't really all get along that well together. We'll look at those things when we return.
You're listening to Conversations on the Coast with Jim Foster. Now you can find this program on iTunes, SoundCloud, and all your favorite digital outlets. Follow the show on Twitter at JimFosterCOC and email JimFosterCOC@gmail.com.
The book is The Great Transformation, the Beginning of Our Religious Traditions. The author, Karen Armstrong, is with us. The publisher is Alfred A. Knopf, and it is a book about which Publishers Weekly says, in part, Armstrong here narrates the evolution of the religious traditions of the world from their births to their maturity. Accounts of the world's religions often present them as discrete entities developing apart from each other in a vacuum, and that's something that you wonderfully avoid. Armstrong's magnificent accomplishment offers us an account of a violent time, much like ours, when religious impulses in various locations develop practices of justice and love. And I want to get to the practices of justice and love, but it seems that I stand corrected in the use of the word intolerance as describing at all the relation among the various religions we're covering.
Yes, once you start having intolerance, as you find it in Plato, for example, Plato, who has a very clear idea of what the people of Athens or other cities should believe, and if they don't believe it, they should be locked up and executed. This is a sign that the Axial Age is about to end. Most of the Axial sages had very little interest in people's theological opinions. The Buddha found these a matter of total indifference. There was a certain competitiveness between the various schools.
Okay.
But all of them insisted, especially in India, that violent speech was unskillful, that the religions of Axial Age India were built on ahimsa, non-violence, and that included not only killing and physical blows, it also included impatient gestures, sighs, irritation, and unkind words. So
that's a wonderful word that they use, unskillful.
Unskillful. Yeah. And again, that is meant to be so that you don't say this is wrong or bad, because that, again, is aggressive. You say it's unskillful in that it won't help you. Unhelpful is also another way of looking at things, of expressing that. And in China, there was a certain amount of competition between what the Chinese call the 100 schools of the Axial Age. But in the end, by the end, they concluded that no one of these schools could possibly have the monopoly of truth.
Of truth.
They finally achieved a wonderful synthesis, seeing the strong points and weak points of each of the schools, Confucianism, Taoism, Yangism, etc., and seeing that we needed all these insights, and that it was, again, as the Taoists had pointed out, very limited and immature to say you can only believe this. As the Taoists used to say, the Confucians and the Moists are at loggerheads, but why can't they both be right?
One of the changes that you focus on here in the study of the history of religious belief is the change from worship that involves killing animals and sacrifices and things of that nature, to a notion of some kind of silent appreciation of getting to the ineffable. On the brink of its axial age, the visionaries of India, you write, were moving beyond concepts and words, which you were talking about, into a silent appreciation of the ineffable.
Yes.
But as the, and I'll probably mispronounce this, Purusha hymn shows, they were still inspired by ancient ritual. Even though the rites were so dangerous and violent, they would remain the inspiration of the great transformation in India. And there's that tension. The notion that I think they had, that they had to give up some of that violence, and yet it was hard to give up because it was part of their history.
It wasn't that they were – what the Indian ritualists did was take all the violence out of the ritual so that the animal was not allowed to be killed or its throat cut painfully. It had to be stunned in some way and killed painlessly outside the sacrificial arena. There were to be no more war games, as there had been in the very ancient rituals, no more fighting. The Indian ritualists, this is the beginning of the Axial Age, the rejection of violence, they turned their backs on any kind of violence in these rites. And more astonishingly, these priests persuaded the warriors to go along with this.
Amazing.
And give up their war games. And in the course of this, they began to discover the inner self as they started to look for the root causes of violence in the human psyche. And religion started to become introspective. Up until that point, religion had been very much a matter of external observance. In the Axial Age, people discovered the inner world.
Looking, as I think you say, for the inner fire, the Atman?
The Atman is the inner self, the core, which the Indians decided was absolutely identical with Brahman, the highest reality of all. So that the divine or the sacred was not just something out there. It was something that every single person could find in the depths of his or her being.
You know, it's obvious that the Great Transformation has much to say about our past. But I wonder, does it have anything to say about today? We're going to find out after this break.
You're listening to Conversations on the Coast with Jim Foster.
Now you can find this program on iTunes, SoundCloud, and all your favorite digital outlets.
Follow the show on Twitter at JimFosterCOC and email JimFosterCOC@gmail.com.
This is Jim Foster. It is Conversations on the Coast, and we are joined today by, quote, the foremost English language historian of religion today. Wow. Wow. That's got to be Karen Armstrong. The book is The Great Transformation, The Beginning of Our Religious Tradition. And they go on to say that magisterially but companionably, it's hard to say.
Yes,
you know,
it is.
She, the English language historian foremost, she unfolds the successive movements that molded religious consciousness in each nation, explaining them with such clarity that this book ranks with A History of God, many feel that's your magnum opus, as one of her finest achievements and an utterly enthralling reading experience. I join those who call it enthralling. It's, new stuff. I had never been acquainted very much with any of this except, you know, some of the Jewish and Catholic tradition. So it was really a wonderful revelation.
Thank
great,
you.
Great experience for
Thank
me.
Great well, it was a great experience for me studying it, actually, and researching it.
You say in the last chapter, The Way Forward, in every single one of the religions of the Axial Age, individuals have failed to measure up to their high ideals. In all these faiths, people have fallen prey to exclusivity, cruelty, superstition, and even atrocity. But at their core, the Axial faiths share an ideal of sympathy, respect, and universal concern. It's the whole sense of falling away from the golden rule. And this is not to be surprised, because you then go on to say the sages were all living in violent societies like our own. What they created was a spiritual technology that utilized natural human energies to counter this aggression. And I think just on that basis alone, one could say they've got, you know, things to say.
Definitely. And very often they seem to be talking directly to us.
Yeah.
About the need for respect for everybody. All they insisted that while compassion was the key virtue, it was compassion, the ability to feel with others that would bring us into the presence of what we call God or Brahman or Nirvana. We couldn't confine our benevolence to our own group. We had to have what the Chinese sages call jian ai, concern for everybody.
I see.
And this is what we need in our world today, because we're drawn together as never before, globally. We're linked electronically, economically. We're very much interconnected. And politically now, what happens in Afghanistan and Iraq today will have repercussions in New York and Washington and London tomorrow. And it is imperative, if we want to hand on a viable world, that we learn to have concern for everybody, to practice the golden rule globally. Do not do to other nations what we would not have done to ourselves. Because otherwise, there's no way we're going to heal the root causes of some of these appalling religiously motivated atrocities.
You've said that these people were not as concerned about doctrine as they were about action. But here you put it so beautifully. Instead of jettisoning religious doctrine, we should look for their spiritual kernel.
Yes.
That's a wonderful idea.
Well, you see, when we look at doctrines such as the Trinity, which a lot of Western people have problems with, we should look at what the Greek Orthodox were trying to achieve when they came to this. They were trying to remind Christians that you couldn't think about God as though God were a simple personality,
okay,
and that that this was indescribable. When they talked about the incarnation, it took them 700 years to find a viable way of saying
that
you saw the divine in Jesus. And I think what they're trying to say is we can't think of the divine without thinking human, because we are human. Neither can we think human without divine. The divine is an essential part of our being. And Jesus is rather, the Greek Orthodox decided, is very similar to what Buddhists came to see the Buddha as. The Buddha was the first enlightened human being in our historical era, so closely identified with Nirvana, that when you looked at the Buddha in meditation, you saw what Nirvana could be in human terms. And Jesus was the first fully deified human being. And the Greek Orthodox say we can all be like him, even in this life.
Finally, you I give what I've labeled in my book. You're not supposed to write in your book, but I did. advice for today. Today, we are making another quantum leap forward. Our technology has created a global society, which you were referring to a few minutes ago, which is interconnected electronically, militarily, economically, and politically. We now have to develop a global consciousness, because whether we like it or not, we live in one world. Even though our problem is different from that of the axial sages, they can still help us. They did not jettison the insights of the old religion, but deepened and extended them. In the same way, we should develop the insights of the Axial Age. Just one small piece of wisdom from the great transformation, the beginning of our religious traditions, by Karen Armstrong. This has been Conversations on the Coast, and I'm Jim Foster.
Now you can find this program on iTunes, SoundCloud, and all your favorite digital outlets.
Follow the show on Twitter at JimFosterCoc and email Jim Foster, COC@gmail.com.